Audiobook, Simply This Moment. Nijnjnana Meditation, 1. Fremantle's Endo. 21st of June 2000. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to come and speak to you all. This is actually the second time that I speak to the Zen group. I want to talk this evening about something that is of use and benefit to everyone who meditates. This evening's talk is on Jhana meditation of the Thai forest tradition, because I thought it would be very useful to everybody here. The heart of Buddhist practice. Everyone would know that the Buddha became enlightened by sitting under a tree and meditating. Meditation is the heart of Buddhist practice and that which has set it apart from other practices and religions. As far as my historical understanding is concerned, I cannot see that there was any practice of meditation, certainly not any quiet meditation, prior to the time of the Buddha. It's as if he rediscovered this path with meditation at its heart. Even though meditation is mentioned in the Upanishads, my understanding, and that of Indian academics, is that those texts date to after the time of the Buddha. The old Pali word for meditation was jhana. This is a very important word because, as you know, when the Buddhist tradition went to China, jhana became chan, and from chan we get zen. So this is the historical context for the roots of meditation. The way of meditation in the Thai forest tradition is the way of just letting go. Many people in our world would like to understand how to let go because we have many problems and difficulties, and many attachments. The fundamental teaching of the Buddha is that an attachment to certain things leads to suffering. So we need to understand how to let go of those attachments. We do this through meditation. This is the process of letting go. One of the first things that impressed me about meditation is that the more you let go, the more happiness comes into your mind. The path of meditation is the path of happiness. In fact, the more you smile, I don't know if you are allowed to smile in the Zendo, but the more you smile, the more it's a sign that you understand about the letting go of suffering. Another thing that impressed me in Buddhism was the fact that the Buddhist monks I met were very happy, especially people like Ajahn Chah, my teacher in Thailand. Not only was the teacher happy, but also, when I read the suttas, I found time and time again that the Buddha was a very happy monk. The people who went to see the Buddha when he was passing through the monasteries, such as the great Jada Grove Monastery outside Savethi, would always comment on how happy the community, the Sangha, looked and how much they smiled. I said in Singapore recently that the greatest marketing tool for Buddhism is the serene smile of a happy meditator. Because, when a person sees that the practice of meditation gives rise to happiness and the ending of suffering and distress, then they too will want to follow that path. They too will want to share that smile. That certainly is the story of my practice of Buddhism. I went to Thailand for one reason. Of all the monks I'd seen in the city of London, where I was born, it was the happy, smiling Thai monks who impressed me the most. I thought that if Buddhism was going to give anything, if it was going to work, then the happiness I saw in those monks is what I wanted to share. Happiness is just the end of suffering, and it is that which encourages people to follow the Buddhist path. That happiness is born of letting go, and the process of meditation is what generates it. But the happiness and meditation have to be grounded on the ease of the body and a very virtuous lifestyle. I'm sure that everyone would agree with me that it's very difficult to sit meditation in the Zendo, or in a meditation hall of any tradition, if, beforehand, you've been acting unskillfully with your body and speech. What I mean by unskillful is doing something that hurts or harms oneself or another. If one cannot let go of such stupidity, then it's so hard to let go of more refined things, and to develop the peaceful state of meditation. That's the reason in the Thai forest tradition, why meditation is grounded on a very pure lifestyle, a lifestyle of harmlessness, a lifestyle of compassion, a lifestyle of the purity of conduct of all the senses. Having achieved that degree of purity, there is a path of letting go in this meditation. You understand from your own experience what letting go means, because when you let go of any obstacle, of any attachment, you experience peace. The sign of letting go is the peace and happiness which arises in the mind. That's why I think many of you would understand that one of the objects of meditation is samadhi. Samadhi is the ability to sustain the attention on one thing with calmness and stillness. The path of letting go. However, recently when I went to teach meditation and Buddhism in Malaysia and Singapore, there was a syndrome which I had never met before in the Thai forest tradition. It was what they called samadhi headache. I don't know if you get Zen headaches, but if you do, you are going in the wrong direction. You can imagine yuppies in Malaysia and Singapore, always trying to control and manipulate their lives. When they sat meditation, they were controlling and manipulating their meditation as well. That is going in the complete opposite direction to the Buddha's teaching. They were meditating to get somewhere. They were meditating to control their body, control their minds, and they were getting into the tension called samadhi headache. I told them that I had never heard of this before. There is something that is important to overcome on the path of meditation. Jhana is the path of letting go more and more. The core teachings of Theravada are the four noble truths. The second and third ones are what I am going to point to this evening. The second truth is craving, which is the cause of suffering. The third truth is letting go. Letting go is the meaning of Nibbana, ultimate happiness. One of the sayings of the Buddha in the suttas is, Nibbana is the highest happiness, and it's that point of happiness which becomes the carrot on this path of meditation. The more you let go, the more happiness you have. The first things that we teach in the forest tradition are the stages of letting go. Just like any other process, there has to be a methodical stage-by-stage abandoning, first the coarse things, then the more refined, then the abandoning of the very refined, until you can let go of everything. It is just like a carpenter who is going to make a beautiful piece of furniture. He takes wood from the woodyard and first of all planes it down to get rid of the rough edges and the burrs which are caused by the saw. Having planed off the rough parts, he uses the coarsest sandpaper, and then medium sandpaper, and then fine sandpaper. After using the finest sandpaper and smoothing the wood as much as possible, he'll finish off with a cloth and some oil or some wax to fine polish this beautiful piece of wood. If you start with the polishing cloth on the rough piece of wood, you'll waste a lot of polishing cloths. This is a simile for the letting go procedure. Abiding in the present moment. This was the way that we were taught by some of the great teachers of Northeast Thailand, and this was the way they practiced. They would sit for hours in peace and happiness with a smile on their face, which in turn would give rise to the wisdom in their teachings. The way they did this was first of all to abandon the past and the future and to abide in the present moment. This is such a simple thing, but it is such a valuable thing to do on the path of meditation. No matter what you are focusing your attention on, whether it's on an object or on silence, it's so easy just to linger on the past and think of what happened earlier. The past is just a memory, the future is just a dream, and once you've completely abandoned them, you are in the present moment. During a recent retreat, I was talking a lot and I made a slip of the tongue. Instead of calling it the present moment, I called it the pleasant moment. I didn't mind that slip of the tongue because it was very true. The present moment is very pleasant because you are letting go of so many burdens. As a monk with many duties and responsibilities, I abide very often in the present moment. In other words, when I come here, I've got no monastery and I've got no Buddhist society in Nathamara. When I'm here, I'm just a monk sitting here in the Zendo. All the past is abandoned. And I don't imagine the future. A good illustration of this comes from a very famous Thai monk who died recently in the south of Thailand. He was building a huge meditation hall in his monastery. When the rainy season came, which in our tradition means we go on retreat for 3 months and all work is stopped, and the retreat started, the roof was only half completed. So when people came and visited that monastery, they would ask this great monk, "When is your hall going to be completed?" He looked at them and said, "It is finished." They looked back at him, saying, "How can you say it's finished? The roof is not finished yet, there are no windows, there are no doors, and it hasn't been painted yet. What do you mean, it's finished?" He would reply, "What's done is finished." That was a beautiful teaching. This is what you should do just before you meditate: say, "What's done is finished." So you don't take all your so-called unfinished business into your meditation. Please do not be a person who has to get everything out of the way before you meditate. If you do that, you'll find you'll never have the time to meditate. If you try and get everything perfect and tie up all your loose ends, you'll find you'll be dead before you can meditate. Loose ends are the normal state of life, and there is always more work to be done. There is always a mess in the kitchen to clean up. What are you living for? To help to clean the kitchen or to have a peaceful mind? So meditation becomes important, or rather the present moment becomes important. What you're doing here is letting go of a lot of business. You're focusing on the only truth you have, which is here and now. Sometimes monks tend to focus so much on the present moment that they sometimes forget what hour it is, what day it is. In my early years as a monk with no responsibilities, and this is no joke, I even forgot what year it was. One day was very much like the next in those monasteries in the jungles of northeast Thailand. You had this beautiful feeling of being in the timeless present moment. Letting go should be your first goal in the meditation. The sign of letting go is freedom. Sometimes people are afraid of freeing themselves. Fear is one of the hindrances to abandonment. We are so attached to our past because it defines us. It's from the past that we have built up our feeling of self, of who we think we are. We are attached to the future because we think if we plan, then we'll find some security, some safety. Some Thai monks tell fortunes, and people would sometimes come up to my teacher, Ajahn Chay, this great meditator, and ask him to tell their fortunes. Ajahn Chay would always, out of compassion and wisdom, agree to do so. He would say to them, "Madam or sir, I'll tell you your fortune. Your future is uncertain." He was always right. So why worry about things that we do not know will happen? How many times have you worried about going to the dentist, for example? You worry yourself sick about something you are afraid of, and when you get to the dentist, you find he's got the flu and cancelled your appointment. What a waste of time that is. So it's just wise, it's common sense, especially in the time of meditation, to forget about all the past and the future and to be free in the present moment. We have a skillful means in the Thai forest tradition that comes from the time of the Buddha, of using what we call mindfulness. To explain mindfulness, I use the simile of a gatekeeper, who can be like the guard at your house. Some rich people have these guards to make sure that burglars do not get in and steal their goods. And they know that mindfulness is much more than bare attention, because if you tell that gatekeeper to just be mindful, be aware, just watch what's going on, you can imagine what happens. When you go home from the temple, you find that people have burgled your house? You ask the guard, weren't you mindful? I told you to guard this house. And the guard says, yes, I was mindful. I saw the burglars going in and I saw them going out with your stereo. I watched them go in again and take all your jewels. I was very mindful. I was fully aware all the time. Would you be very happy with that guard? Of course you wouldn't. Remember that this guard mindfulness has a job to do, and that job is to abandon, to let go of certain things. You have to tell that guard very clearly that you want to let go of the past and the future, so that you can dwell in the present moment. When you tell your guard that, the mind can do it quite easily as you go deeper into the present moment and become accustomed to the happiness and freedom of just being in the now. In the next stage of the meditation, you will find that you can't even think. I'm not sure if any of you like music, but if you are listening to a beautiful piece of classical music in a great theater or concert hall, do you ever turn around to the person next to you and start talking, saying what a wonderful piece of music it is? If you did, you'd get thrown out, and for good reason, because as soon as you start talking, it means you are no longer listening. It's the same with your mind. When you think of something or label something, it means you're no longer listening. It's like being a host at a party. Your job is just to greet the visitors when they come in, not to linger in conversation. Because if you have a conversation with one guest, it means you are not paying attention to the guest who is coming right behind. The stream of the present moment, if it is attended to fully, gives no time for thought or for inner conversation. In that silence, there is a deepening of what I call contentment. It's just like two old people who have been living together for so many years. They know each other so well, they're so at ease in each other's company, that there is no need to talk. In the same way, when you are fully at ease with the present moment, there is no need to say anything. All thinking is a sign of discontent. All thinking is a sign of wanting to escape to somewhere else. So much of thinking is what should I do next? When contentment arises in the mind, such thoughts cannot arise. In the meditation that I teach, I always ask people to recognize the happiness of the present moment and also the happiness of silence. Each of those is very beautiful. Once you realize the happiness of those states, there's no need to make any effort to meditate. There's no need to try. The mind by itself will always incline to where it finds happiness. This is one of the beautiful teachings of the Buddha found in the suttas. Once that happiness is perceived, you do not even need to think or make a resolution or decision, may I go deeper into samadhi or stillness, because these things happen all by themselves. In these stages of meditation, it's not a case of going on to something else, it's a case of going deeper into this present moment. You go deeper into where you are, as you go into the silence of the mind and start to notice the happiness of silently being, without needing to say anything at all. When that happiness is acknowledged, you find that you cannot speak in the same way. You can be watching a movie on the television and you don't say anything to anybody because you are enjoying every moment of what is happening. Here you are watching beautiful, peaceful silence. In the path of meditation, there has to be a deepening of the silence of the present moment. It's a deepening from diversity to unity, in the same present moment awareness. In silence, the mind can still go out to many things, to the body, sounds, all sorts of different objects. In jhana meditation, there is the focusing of the mind on just the one chosen object, with that silent awareness just focusing on one thing. One is now letting go of the diversity of the mind, what you might call the duality of the mind, or the movement of the mind from one thing to another. This will often happen quite naturally. In the silence, there will always be one thing that appears to be beautiful and happy. I was taught to choose to watch the breath. We watch the breath without controlling. Just being a silent observer, telling that gatekeeper to just stay with the breath as it goes in and out. As you get closer to the breath, you don't even know if it's going in or going out, you just know this breath that is happening now. This is like a carpenter who is sawing a piece of wood, focusing closer and closer on the point where the saw meets the wood. He cannot tell whether he's focusing on the beginning or the end of the saw. All you know is this part of breath is happening now. Sometimes people who try breath meditation have great difficulty because of controlling. It is especially at this stage of the meditation that one has to let go of something that is very deep inside of us, the will. When we try and do this, we often see how much we are trying to control and manipulate, and this is what always messes up our meditation. This is a cause for samadhi headaches. Knowing that there's a problem, analyzing and seeing what the difficulty is, there is always a way of overcoming it. In meditation, as in other parts of life, if we know the problem, we can always avoid it. I give people the simile of the snakes. It's my own simile drawn from the time when I was living in Ajahn Chah's monastery in Thailand. These were jungle monasteries, and in those jungles there were many snakes. You'd see far more snakes in Thailand in just one day than I've seen in years in Australia. The place was crawling with snakes. When I first went there, I was told that there are 100 species of snake in Thailand, 99 of them are poisonous and the other one crushes you to death. So they are all very dangerous. There was no electricity, sometimes we didn't have batteries for our flashlights, and sometimes we didn't even have sandals. It was a very poor monastery. After the evening meditation, we had to walk from the hall in the darkness using the stars or moonlight to light the way through the jungle back to our huts, which were sometimes 500 meters away. Because I knew there were snakes about, I was always on the lookout for them. And, because I was on the lookout for them, because I was mindful of the danger, I could always see them in plenty of time. I would step around them or jump over them, but I never stepped on them. Actually, once I nearly stepped on one. Fortunately, the snake jumped one way and I jumped the other way. We were both very happy that we didn't choose the same direction. I never stepped on one because I was always looking out for them. In the same way, whatever problems and difficulties you have in your meditation, if you really appreciate that it's a problem and you know it's a danger, then you will look upon it like a snake. That means you will be able to see it in good time before it can bite you. And this is how we can avoid the problems in our meditation. Whether it's sleepiness, too much thinking, or whether it's the mind wandering from one thing to another, know your snake and then you'll be able to take evasive action before it really gets a hold of you. The thinking mind, once it gets hold of you, is hard to stop. Anger, once it grabs hold of you, bites and bites, you cannot get it off. If you avoid it, then you are free. On this path of meditation, concentrating on the breath or concentrating on any one thing is just a way of overcoming problems by keeping the sense activities still. At least you are letting go of most of the five senses. By just watching one thing, all the other senses disappear. You can neither hear nor feel the rest of the body, and smell and taste have already gone. This letting go of the five senses is very profound because they define our mind and body. If we meditate very deeply, we won't be able to hear anything of the sounds outside. In the same way, just giving a simile from ordinary life, when you watch the television, sometimes you can't hear your partner saying dinner is ready, or you can't hear the telephone. Two of my disciples, I'm embarrassed to say, were watching the television one evening in their house, and when The program finished, they looked around and noticed that a few things were missing from the room. A burglar had been into their house, came right into the room where they were watching the TV, and stole things from right behind them. They had been so engrossed in the movie they hadn't even heard this very cheeky burglar. I don't encourage that. But in meditation, if it happens, you are getting somewhere. What it means is that you have been able to let go of concern for the world outside. And you are getting closer and closer to what we call the mind. As you all know, in Buddhism there are six senses. The five external senses dominate the consciousness. So much that it's like an emperor with knee-high boots, trousers, a big jacket, a hat on, and a scarf around his head so you can't see anything of him. All you can see are the garments covering the emperor from head to toe. In that simile, the emperor stands for the mind, the hat is sight, the scarf sound, the jacket smell, the trousers taste, and the boots touch, completely covering that which we call the mind, completely covering that which we call the mind, completely covering that which we call the mind, completely covering.